feeling since I saw you last. We've been talking about this new year, a series called Reset, and we've been talking about health in different ways. And one of the things that I've encouraged you to do each week is to evaluate your health in regard to a specific issue. But I need to talk to you this morning because I don't want you to think that any one of these areas overrides the other. We started talking about relational health the first week right after we got into the series in January. Then we talked about community health. Last week we talked about physical health. And here's what I mean when I say that you don't want to let any one of these override the other. On Tuesday, I tried to get someone to go to lunch with me. And all they want to do is eat vegetables, carrots, eat healthy. And I'm thinking, well, what about your relational health or your community health? You hung me out to dry here because all of a sudden you decided to address your physical health.
And now I don't have anybody to go to lunch with.
Well, we want to make sure that in the process of evaluating our health that we cover every one of these areas. And it has been interesting as I've gotten feedback after last week. It was interesting doing a series or doing a message thinking about our physical health. It's not something I'd ever done before, and I wasn't sure what the response would be. But I'm glad that many of you have thought about that. We have gone through the process of putting together some of the information you gave us on your profiles, your activity questionnaire. And if you haven't filled one of those out, there's some of those on the table in the foyer. And we'd encourage you to do that because we do want to do some things together as a church that are activity-oriented but will also develop our relational and community health. Well, this morning I want to talk about evaluating and thinking about our financial health. And this is an interesting subject. It's a subject that for us at this particular time of year falls somewhere between that time that you got your January credit card statement, which has your Christmas on it, and before you get your IRS return sometime in the next few weeks. So we feel like that it's not this audience right here, that there's some people who ought to be interested in what we're going to talk about in terms of financial health, that these things do relate to us, particularly at this time of year. And the thing that we want to do is we want to start with, like we have each week, just say, evaluate what your circumstances are. And we don't have a deep way to do that or accomplish that this morning, but one of the simple ways is this. Just simply, if you look at your notes, you evaluate kind of on this graph where you feel like that you are at this moment. Some might say, well, I'm on course. Things are going well. Some might say at this time that in my terms of my financial health, I need improvement. Or you could say, maybe you're struggling right now, and there could be a variety of reasons why you might be, why a person might be struggling with their financial health at any given time. Or some of us might be saying, we're in trouble. I want you to know that probably not a lot different than you guys. At some time in my life, I've checked off every one of those boxes. There's been times in my life where I was struggling. There were times when I was on course. There was times when I was in trouble. But God has moved through our life and helped us to navigate life where we can move through those areas, and all the time we deepen our relationship with God through understanding the resources that God has given to us. And when we think about that, what we want to think about really is we understand is that it is God that makes this provision for us. And you may think that it's that your employer, or for some of you, it's your parents. But really, God is responsible for placing you in charge of the resources that you're provided, and so you have to work within your own context and understanding and developing that and growing and deepening your understanding of what financial health really looks like. So we want to say to you this morning, regardless of where you are currently, there's a chance that you may experience all of these others in a short period of time or throughout the rest of your lifetime. But regardless of where you are, God knows where you are, and there's time for you to bring some correction and some help to where you are. The text that we want to use this morning is found in Matthew 25. And it's a story that the Bible, when we talk about these stories from Scripture in Matthew, we refer to them as parables. They're kingdom parables. They help us understand a little bit more about God. They help us understand a lot more about the kingdom and the world that God's placed us in, and how those two things interact. Now, as we read through parables, we see them cover a variety of areas, just like we have through our current series entitled Reset. And in covering those areas, we begin to understand how it is that God works through us so that we can work in the kingdom of God that God has placed us in for a specific time. The one that we want to look at today is in Matthew 25, and it starts in verse 14. It goes like this. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. And the man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work, and he gained 5 bags more. So also the one who had 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned, and he settled their accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I've gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man with 2 bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I've gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you were a hard man, harvesting where you've not sown and gathering where you've not gathered seed. So I was afraid, and I went out and hid your gold in the ground, and here's what belongs to you. I almost feel like as if there ought to be a ta-da at the end of that, but there wasn't. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I've not sown and gather where I've not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him. Give it to the one who has 10 bags, for whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even when they have, will be taken, what they have will be taken from them. Throw the worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is a picture for us
that an important one that we need to grasp. And that's this, that before God, we have responsibility for the resources that God places in front of us.
Regardless of where we are in life or what we consider our resources, we are the managers of the resources that God provides. And so it's our responsibility to take whatever it is, whether it's 5 bags or 2 bags or 1, and we take those resources and we are responsible for them, not just for God, but for ourselves and for others. And when we evaluate our life in terms of our financial health this morning, we look at these areas and we begin to ask ourselves, I believe, some important questions. And those questions lead us, hopefully, on a path that will help us to have more responsibility with more resources as God directs us in this path that he has for us. How is it that you've responded to the responsibility that God has given you? Forget for a moment where you are on the evaluation chart that I just put out there. Just ask yourself this morning as you sit here and you think about this, as you grapple with yourself, with the responsibilities that you have and what you're doing, how well are you managing those resources that God has given you? Because I know here's what happens when we read this passage. The tendency that we have is this. There are people in here who feel like if God gave them 5 bags of gold, they could go out and double it. There's those kind of folks in the room. There's folks in the room going, you give me 2 bags, I can go out and I can make another 2 bags. We know how to do that. And there's some people who are going, well, I don't really know what to do. If you don't really know what to do, then listen this morning. Because what happens, the picture that we have in Scripture is not knowing what to do and doing nothing is not good enough. In fact, Jesus said, if you're not getting any better return for your money, first, because you're lazy. Now, lazy may not mean that you're not willing to work hard. Lazy may simply mean that you're not willing to invest in yourself. You know, there's not a lot of things that I know how to do. In fact, of all of my circle of friends, if you were to line us up or put us all in a room, I'm probably the most untalented of anyone in the room. But I've learned to do one thing. If I don't know how to do something, I go out and figure out how to do something. And a lot of you are that way. And what we're saying this morning is it's not an excuse to be lazy and to not do anything with the resources that God has given us. It's not enough for us to manage by hiding who we are before God and before the people that God has given us responsibility for. We have to go out and make an investment in ourselves so that we can make an investment in others. As I've thought about this, in particular, since I've had the opportunity throughout my life to be in and out of some businesses, and also in and out of ministry, staff ministry experiences, one of the things that I've noticed is this, is that oftentimes we don't talk about an important word in the life of the church in regard to finance or our responsibility. And here's the word I want you to zero in on. If you go back and reread that the context of that text, of that story, of that parable, reread it with this idea of how might I invest my life. You see, what happened was is that the first guy knew how to invest. He knew how to go out and to reproduce what had already been given to him. And because he did, he received much more than he had ever invested in the first place. The second story is similar, just with less responsibility. The last is dramatically different. He chose not to invest at all. Now, why wouldn't a person invest? If they're lazy, it may be that they never think that they have, within their own lives and own experience and context, that they never have anything to contribute. And the reality is that the way that God has created us in His image, all of us have something that we can contribute. All of us have a role that we can play in this kingdom experience. We have no excuses for being lazy and not looking into or trying to do some of the things that we feel like that we ought to do. Sometimes it's not just that we're lazy, it's that we're afraid that we're going to fail. I learned an important lesson this last year. There's nothing wrong with failure. There's no one who has received it, had any kind of success in their life that hasn't failed. If you don't believe me, go back to some early experience in your childhood when your parents made you do things that you didn't really want to do because they thought you might have a career in it. I played the piano when I was young. That's my example. If you are going to fail, do this. Fail fast. And get to the next thing that you need to try. This morning, what we want to experience is we do want to look at the experience that we have and the way that God has blessed us and the way that we know how to empower that and to multiply that and to see that grow. That is so important in the kingdom of God. We cannot be happy with status quo. We can't be happy with simply managing things. We have to be responsible for everything that God has given to us. And as a church, we have to accept that responsibility and go out into the world and see that ministry multiply over and over and over again. And the difference between an investment and putting something in a hole is not the difference between addition and multiplication. When you read the story of the early church, they didn't just start adding people. They got to a place where it was being multiplied over and over again as thousands came to know Jesus. We have responsibility. We have to own this. We have to take charge of this in our life. And it may start with us making an investment in ourselves to figure this out. Now, you probably picked up on it, but I'm not just talking about dollars. I'm not just talking about finances. But I'm also talking about your responsibility in terms of your resources in helping and in seeing the kingdom of God grow and multiply. He said that he was lazy. And sometimes we suffer from laziness. They also considered him wicked. So let me just make a quick conclusion here. When we fail to invest the kingdom resources that God has placed in our hands, is sin. If it's sin in our life, we have a responsibility to confess it and to repent. In other words, we have the responsibility, if there's something that's not right in our life about this area, for this area of our life, then we have the responsibility to bring correction into our own life through the power of God. We can't just settle, we can't just be happy with the way things are. We have to let God speak to us and respond to what God says to us. And sometimes that includes repentance. We may have to change our ways. You may, in order to get to the place where you want to be in terms of your financial health, you may have to change your ways. You may have to do some things that you're not accustomed to doing.
You may have to start some things to generate some new habits in your life, along with eating carrots and other things like that that you started doing.
On your note sheet, put it simply this way, that creating a new mindset for us might be that we don't think in terms of just managing resources, but we think in terms of investing our resources. We want to be in the word that we use a lot of times in church life. I don't know that I really hear it a lot outside the life of the church, but the word that we use a lot of times is stewardship. And that's basically looking at these areas of our life and asking God how it is that we manage them in a way that would honor Him, would honor God, and increase the kingdom of God. So the mindset that I want us to start talking about and developing and living through is a mindset of investing, not just managing. The first two guys invested the resources that God had given them. The last one simply managed. So figure out, evaluate your life, and determine how it is that you can stay, remain healthy and financially productive. And it's not always easy. Sherry and I married while we were still in college, and immediately I took a student ministry position, which also meant that immediately I took a cut in pay. My dad was furious with me, but I thought, well, I think we can make this work. And so we were just married and trying to figure out what we were going to do. And we moved from Abilene to Albany. The First Baptist Church Albany was my first really full-time ministry position. And we were finishing up my last semester at Hardin-Simmons and getting ready to embark on a career in student ministry. And I'd been raised with my family to be a little bit fiscally responsible. And so I gave to the church from the time that I was in eighth grade. I was a tither. I gave to the church regularly, and so even though we looked at what we were making at that particular time, and it didn't seem like much, that's the first thing that happened, is that we wrote our tithe check to the church. But at the end of the month, we were having that experience that I hear people talk about, that we had more of the month than we had a balance, and so we had days to go that we didn't have money in the bank, and so it got hard. It got discouraging. As I worked through that process, it became more of a mental challenge than anything else. I was just feeling defeated because I didn't know what we were going to do, and I'd always been able to work and to make money and to make provision. And so out of desperation, back then I carried a briefcase. That sounds kind of corny now, but I did. I carried a briefcase. I carried it to work because I wanted to be professional. I wanted to learn this profession. And there was a pocket in the front of that briefcase. And in that pocket, I had an envelope. It was this size envelope. And on the front, I wrote $1. I was so desperate to not lose the habit of being able to save money. I thought, at least in order to stay in the habit of saving money. Every week, every Monday, I took a dollar, I placed it in this envelope, and put it in the front pocket of my briefcase. From that, there was a deep sense of satisfaction. And it wasn't just that we were struggling, but it helped me to know that there would be a day, there would be a time when things would be better than a $1 bill in an envelope. But even in the darkest time of our financial life, there was going to be at least $1 a week that was going to go into that. I don't know where you are this morning on that scale, but I do know how defeating it can be when you're struggling. When you really are living trying to pay off the last Christmas that you bought on credit cards. I know what that's like. Also knows what it's like to wonder whether you're going to make it. When we started one of the businesses that we got involved in, we were losing money faster than I had ever knew was possible. And I resourced another thing that I was doing in order to pay for it. And eventually, those weren't even meeting up. And we were in trouble. Sharon was worried about it. I was worried about it. I didn't know what we were going to do. And ultimately, the turning point came when I decided to learn business. I was an idea person. So I thought there were things that I would do that were great ideas. But I really didn't know business. And so I did what I've done since, or from the time I was in college. I went to the library and got some books. And here's what I've learned. It's easy to make money. It is easy to make money. It's difficult to make a profit. And what the difference in struggle and being secure is in that one idea. We're making money, but we're not making a profit. And things got hard. Well, we learned through that. And I learned to close that gap, to close it where it would work better. And more efficiently, more effectively. And then we got out of it. I've been just like you on all parts of that story up there. And here's what I know, is that God wants us to not be lazy, to be responsible, and to do what He's asked of us with the resources that He's given us. And here's what I've learned, is that you can figure out how to make things come together. You really can. But here's the remaining question. Can you figure out how to get things to come together in a way that honors God? You see, ultimately, in this story, what Jesus is talking about is how to live life with others in this kingdom of God where others know Him and God is glorified. Even if it's through the resources that He gives us. So what this means is, as we start to broaden this picture, is that in every area of our life, as we give it over to God in completeness, in wholeness, then God begins to draw us closer to who He is and helps us and equips us so that we not make a difference in the world that He's given us. But it all comes back to that. Are we willing to honor God with the resources that He's given us? This idea of an investment is not one that was created by any banker. I believe it was created by God. And God invested in us by giving us His Son Jesus. Jesus invested in His disciples. His disciples invested in the church. And the church He's invested in changing the world. There's no exemption for any person who chooses to follow Jesus. We all have a responsibility to take it a little bit further so that we can honor Him and the things that we do.
Thank you for joining us at First Baptist Church. We hope you can join us again, online or in person, in Sweetwater, Texas, as we learn to live out God's calling in the world around us.